have been an amazing audience of attentive listeners, and I think the next thing is to give you a chance to ask questions of the members of the panel. So, yes. The question was, maybe people who are scientists and engineers who have a great deal of knowledge don't want to participate in the legal system because of, or a particular case, because of where they think their information is going to go, how it's going to be used. One of the questions we asked was, included an opportunity to say that you didn't want to work for one side or you didn't agree with the outcome. Those were relatively rare reasons for people to refuse to participate, but people did mention them, so that is included in the article. Yeah, great. So the question is, if scientists who are located and engineers who are located at universities have had bad experiences with their research attorneys controlling what they can do and can't do, whether that infects the view of participating in the legal system more generally. Yes.
Well, first of all, no one likes lawyers. Come on, this is a universal law of nature. And secondly, more seriously, it is the role of lawyers to say no. That is very much the role of, particularly of inside lawyers, to stop people who are without realizing it, going beyond what the law requires or what good risk management requires. I think my experience has been that, and the study did comment on this, is that some scientists I know have not wanted to participate in the deposition process of a litigation where a really nasty lawyer, really well-paid lawyer, has them all alone in a room with a reporter but without a judge and gives them really nasty, unfair, misleading questions, which is the way depositions operate. It's not the way the ultimate proof is presented to a judge or jury, but that's been, for what it's worth, that's what I've been told has been a more grave impediment.
And Rick has something from the survey that he wants to.
Yeah, let me just say, we did ask a question about whether institutional policies were a reason why scientists refused to participate. It was a very, very rare reason given. And I also want to just emphasize, you're asking, you know, good questions about, but these are about small issues. The overwhelming story of refusal to participate is, number one, time, and number two, a sense that this was not an appropriate case for a scientist with this training to participate in. So the around these edges, there are all these other concerns and reasons, but the real core is that it's sort of exactly how you might want the system to work if you were designing it, that people don't participate when they don't feel they can add anything, and of course they don't participate if they don't have the time to do a good job.
And there's one more thing to that, which is that people who participated tended to rate the lawyers they worked with as much higher than people who hadn't participated. So the question is, do they learn something from that participation about the ability of the lawyers to handle scientific material? Not sure.
Yes, and it's also not very surprising, they rated the lawyers with whom they worked far higher than the lawyers for the other side.
Yes. The question was, there has been some push in some quarters for a complexity exception to have jurors not have to face very complicated technical cases. And then the response to that has been that are there ways that you can make the case presentation clearer for jurors and judges so that these complex cases can be handled?
I think there have been efforts. That's been going on for a long time. It wasn't just a science issue. That was a complexity exception that could have been for legally complex cases. The first issue was, how do you define it and what goes into that box? And if that box meant that it would be very different procedures, then the definition of what's complex would be determinative. In other words, we shy away from that because we don't know what the meets and bounds of what a complexity exception might look like and are concerned that it's a basis for manipulation. But in addition, that also predated high-tech methods of communicating with juries. And when I was on the bench, I left about 5 or 6 years ago, the beginning of, you know, using the technology to teach was enormously impressive. You can put something on the screen that would unpack things that otherwise you had, you know, somebody on a blackboard trying to do. So that's been helpful. In the Daedalus volume, there are efforts to talk. We were addressing this wonderful concept of hot tubbing, which I just love it, which is putting the experts on both sides to be testifying at the same time, so that they, or sequentially, one right after the other, so that they would each be specifically addressing what the other has said, and more significantly, that they meet in advance to try to narrow what the differences and the those things that are similar as an effort to deal with one part of the complexity problem, which is wildly differing experts. So the technology, I think, is making things easier. I think that we're trying to come up with ways of taking the hard edges off the adversary system with respect to experts. But I also think that there is if the complexity exception means that certain complex cases take a different track, that's different. Different track ultimately leading to a jury trial. That's one thing. But if the complexity exception meant, as it was when I was teaching jury courses, that these were cases that are inappropriate for juries, there's a constitutional problem with that, and then there's a very, you know, fundamental category problem with that. What are the cases that should avoid Seventh Amendment analysis? So I think the bottom line is, this is the system we have, and the issue is how do you make what we have more understandable using all the tools we have?
Yeah, about 25 years ago, there was this real push to find a complexity exception to the Seventh Amendment. And I wrote two articles on this very topic, so I'm grateful for the question. That I basically looked at every single case study I could find of a complex case that involved a jury trial. This was not a large number, maybe a small sample, 20 or so cases. Complexity had two dimensions. One was length of trial, and the other was scientific evidence. And very often they went together. To give you the bottom line that I found is that juries usually, but not always, got things, if not absolutely correct by some general gold standard, certainly defensibly correct. But what I also found, and I was probably going to refer to this anyway because of what Judge Rakoff said earlier, where he talked about the judge's issues and the jury's issues with science. They actually cannot be separated. That in those cases where the jury got things right, the judge got things right. You had a good judge who guided the jury, who may have intervened, asked questions of the scientific expert to clarify, and the jury did that. Where the jury got it wrong, you would not have wanted that judge to have decided by him or herself, because the judge did not handle the jury well, and sometimes the judge made obvious errors of scientific facts. So you can't separate out the jury from the judge in trials.
The one thing I would add to the very excellent comments already made is that to some extent we make a mistake in focusing too much on juries, because jury trials are largely rare, very rare. The statistics are that only about 3% of the cases in the United States go to a jury trial. The rest are either settled, or they're dismissed on motions, or are resolved in other ways. That doesn't make jury trials unimportant, because they're still the ultimate test, but it does mean that we need perhaps to focus particular attention on the earlier segments like the Daubert hearing.
We have time for one more question. Well, maybe more than one, but go ahead. Yeah. The question identifies the structural difference between the normal civil situation and the criminal situation, and the criminal situation where the forensic science comes from laboratories associated with law enforcement. And the question was about the potential bias in that being different from an ordinary scientific laboratory situation. And is there anything that judges can do about that?
I was just on a panel where in Houston, there were numbers of wrongful convictions. It was a great controversy. The fact of the wrongful convictions led the Houston Crime Lab to reevaluate the way they were doing things. It wasn't that a judge said, do it this way or that way, but it was that there were a number of wrongful convictions and then an examination of how it happened and the relationship between scientific evidence to that. They then created a separate unit that would be a testing unit, totally divorced from the prosecutor, run by scientists. And they have been independently funded, because funding was an issue. If the recommendation for funding has to go through the prosecutor, the independence is lost. And they have been remarkably successful in both coming up with results that people find to be legitimate and be freed from any of the challenges of other forensic science. Now, a judge didn't order them to do that. That came about politically because of wrongful convictions, which judges had endorsed. It's very difficult for a judge to order that. In fact, it's impossible for a judge to order that unless you would come to a conclusion that I can't imagine any judge would come to, which is to say, because it's a state crime lab, by definition, it has to be biased. And of course, a judge wouldn't say that. But that's the structural problem that you're talking about.
So just to add to that, the difficulty a judge faces is a judge could say, I'm not going to allow this evidence in because it hasn't been independently tested. That might be a possible approach under Daubert. But that's a very extreme kind of approach to take. In the ephedra case I had, the civil case, it would have been great to have an epidemiological study. None had been made of whether ephedra causes heart attacks or strokes. And the party said, oh, you can have, we agree you can have a epidemiological study. It'll take about 2 years. It'll take about $5 million. We're not going to give you any of that money. But if that's what you want to do, judge, please. You know, so that was not a realistic alternative.
One more question. So the question is for the judges, and the alternatives given are, is the idea of having judges interact with scientists to have judges learn how to think like a scientist or to get information from the scientific content. And then the second part was, that prospect of doing science with lawyers
an attractive one, or do judges feel that they can really handle the science ultimately? Is that correct?
I think maybe the answer is a bit of both. And I can only speak from my own experience, but I've learned a lot about the scientific process and how it works by listening to scientists at these meetings and by reading what they've written. And I think that has made me better able to handle some of these very complex cases. I do think law schools should have far more, I'm a little out of touch with what they're actually teaching, but I think law schools should be concentrating on, or have serious programs on, science and technology so that law students come, whether they're practicing law or whether they become judges. If there's any trend that I've seen, I've been on my court for 25 years, I'd say the most dramatic trend has been the increasing complexity of our cases in terms of the science and the technology. So I think, and I know a lot of law schools already do this, but law schools need to equip their graduates to think about this. I would be, you know, the ultimate question is, should we have science courts? I mean, you didn't say that, but, you know, in the patent field, we have a court of appeals that does just patents. That's all it does. I mean, excuse me, it does other work, but it's the only appellate court that receives patent cases. That's one interesting idea. I myself think that our judicial system works best with generalist judges who are educated by the parties. I think history has proven that that's the best system, and that specialized courts would not be a good idea. But that's not the same as saying that judges shouldn't learn as much about science as they can, because, you know, again, from my own experience, it has helped me think about these complex cases in ways that I wouldn't have but for those conversations.
Trial judges are almost all former trial lawyers. And trial lawyers are, by the nature of the beast, quick studies. And virtually every trial lawyer will tell you that when they first got a case in some obscure substantive area, they knew nothing about that particular area. But by the time the case went to trial, they probably knew more than about that area than any of the witnesses who testified. They had really immersed themselves in it. And of course, they forgot it all the next day after the trial was over. So I think that's, we should take advantage of that ability of judges. I think it would be wonderful if they learned how scientists think as a body, and that's important, but I think realistically what we have to do is aid them in their ability to understand the particular science and the particular issue that is before them in a particular case, and make that make facilities and resources and procedures available to help them do that. I think that's a more realistic approach.
There are certainly I agree with Judge Tatel that it was so. I take both sides of your question. The judges have to know what science means, the scientific method, and the way the PCAST report talked about foundational validity and validity as applied. They have to know what crosses the threshold between, you know, non-science and science. So to that degree, I think there's a certain minimum that judges have to know as a framework within which to evaluate any particular science. That was the gatekeeping role. What Judge Rakoff is talking about is the particulars of a given case. Obviously, that doesn't make any sense. You can't have judges be neuroscientists and psychiatrists and, you know, epidemiologists, but certainly to know what all of scientists know, which is what's the bedrock that distinguishes science from non-science, and that judges have to know and be prepared to enforce.
There is a more complex background to some of this, and we've had a really good session of questions. Just to close, I would say that the Federal Circuit, the specialized court, had hearings at my law school at Northwestern. And the question was for the members of that panel who hear patent cases, what their scientific backgrounds were. And none of the three of them had a scientific background, but they came to give the sessions with their clerks. And so there were eight clerks sitting along the wall. And one of the judges said, well, would you like to hear about the background of our judicial clerks?
Oh, wow.
And all but one of them had a scientific background. So it's not just the court, it's also the clerks.
So now you know who really decides cases.
And just finally, I'd like to say thank you so very much. These are particularly wonderful and thoughtful judges. And if all of the judiciary looked like them, we would all be better off. So thank you.